Welcome back for another edition of HPI Guys Model Workshop. On this build review, we're going to be putting together TACOM Russian MRAP Typhoon K. Look at that monster. That's my hand. That's the size of the box. This is in 1/35th scale. It is by TACOM. I've never built a kit by them before, so I'm excited to dig in and see how those go. I'm hoping it's going to be as good as companies like Tamiya and Hasegawa. So let's take a look at everything that's going to be inside the box when you get yours. First up will be an assembly book. Not just a booklet, but an actual book. Fold-out pages. I'm hoping it goes together pretty smooth. It's all exploded views. No words or anything. All part number call-outs and whatnot. And I'm glad to see that the glass goes in from the outside. That's going to help me quite a bit. In the back of the manual will be a full-color paint and illustration guide. Not much to do with this one. It's going to be green. And then some other product call-outs. So let's take a look at other stuff that's in the box. First up, massive parts trees. These won't even fit my parts washer. I'm actually going to have to fill the sink in the workshop itself. They won't fit in where I wash my parts. They're just too big. But you can see all that sweet detail of the outside and bottom hull. Look at the nose on that truck. Gorgeous molding, all nicely done in gray. I'm going to be airbrushing this one in a Russian green. I've picked up some new paint from Mission Models, and I'm going to be trying that out. But you can see the nice instrumentation inside the crew area and the nice dashboard in the cockpit. Now, there are no decals for any of that, so that will all have to be hand-painted and detailed. What I did was go online and look up what these look like on the inside, and I'll try to get it as close as I can to that. You can see a lot of the interior parts, doors, armored equipment. Look at the detail on those grates and vents. Look at that ladder. Look at that injection molding on that ladder. And that's not as small as it goes, but a huge amount of detail. Look at those little parts there. Grab handles. Look at those vents. Really cool looking. Now we got two identical trees here, so we only have to look at one, but we've got drive shaft details. This does not have an engine, since you'd have to be able to remove part of the cab and everything and all the armor to get to it. They do not have you detail the engine, just the interior, which can be viewed through the windows and the hatches. Look at those little clips there. That is some small stuff. We got the nice seats in there. The seats are a black vinyl from what I looked up. White metal and black vinyl. Nice detail on the wheels. And hatches. A lot of hatches. 7 hatches on this vehicle, so we'll get that out of the way. Let's go to the other side now. There's the hull. Look at the size of that thing. Big. What else do we have in the kit? We got glass, we have a little bit of photo etch, we got a very tiny amount of decals, and we got the sweet tires. We'll take a look at all this. Look at the molding detail on that cab. How they get angled vents to come out of a mold like that. And this isn't broken. This is supposed to be separate on the real thing. So it's molded separate, but looks like it joins right in. I don't know how they do that, but I'm always amazed at the technology. Beautiful molding. You can see on this one, of course, the windows go in from the outside, that armored glass, and then the doors. Looks like the doors will be able to be opened. The tires. You get 6 of them. Michelin-branded tires, and they definitely look the part. Those are just yummy. You get 6 of those because it's a 6x6. You get only a small set of decals, parade decals, and Russian stars. You get a little thing of photo etch for the grills, but isn't that cool? So we'll be doing a little photo etch work. You'll need super glue for that. Regular model glue, of course, won't affect brass whatsoever. And then the beautifully flat clear windows and headlights. The clear windows, I'm going to attempt to tint a mild green with Tamiya Clear, and we'll see how that turns out. So I'm going to get all this stuff into the workshop tub and get it cleaned. I'm going to start doing some sub-assemblies. It's going to be a lot to assemble all at once, and then I'll show you guys the detail. I'll be back. I'm up to step number 6 on page 5 of the build, and it's taken a couple hours to get to this point. Why? Because there are so many things to do in every step leading up to this point. I mean, there are a ton of detail parts to put on this kit, and that's the way modern military modelers want it. They want every fine detail reproduced, so you're going to get a chance to reproduce it. Now, you can see the glue with the tint on it and all these different spots. There's got to be 100 parts in this assembly here. from the tiniest suspension pieces to the shocks to the suspension arms to the shock mounts. Everything's got about two or three pieces in it. You even build these boxes separately that you see right here and assemble the mud flaps on them separately and glue them in place. And you can see how that goes, and then these three large blocks go in and assemble that. Speaking of the large blocks, make sure you pay attention. The manual says the open end goes one direction on the back and the other direction on the front because of the way the vehicle is driven and operated. So that's how that's set. When something like this you're putting together, a really great glue is what you want. The tube glue is simply not going to cut it on a build like this because it takes too long to dry. So if you wanted to spend 9 hours getting to this point waiting for the glue to dry, that's fine. You can still use tube glue. There's nothing wrong with it. It's just that if you go with a more solvent-based glue, I use Bondine because it just really melts the plastic together. You can use Testor's Extra Thin. You can use Testor's in the bottle with the brush, the clear stuff. You can use any of the Mr. Hobby glues. Any of that kind of stuff will work great. But when you want to get something together and you don't want to wait a month for it to dry and you want it to hold these little tiny pieces in place, you can just dab it on, touch the piece to it, and it instantly holds, allowing you to apply more glue and hold it in place. Now, I'm pretty judicious. I'm pretty generous with the glue on a build like this because, one, it's getting painted, of course. You're not going to notice it. Two, I want parts to hold. I don't want to be lifting it up, moving it around, and use just a teeny little drop of glue and have it fall apart. You know, when these boxes are assembled, I want them to hold straight. So, like I said, you're looking at almost like 100 parts, at least I'm guessing, that I put in this one just to get to step number 6 in assembling. This, of course, is the backbone of the MRAP of the Typhoon with all the driveline assemblies. Next, you can see we're going to be doing the steering. Now, this kit does allow you to have steerable rear wheels and front wheels on this machine. I'm not going to do that, so I'm going to line everything up straight, glue it into place, and leave it. I don't play with my models, and I'm not putting this one in a diorama, so I don't have any reason to have the wheels turned at all. I'm going to have them all going straight forward, and then they have you assemble it to that sub-assembly that we've created here. So I'm going to go ahead, keep working on everything, set this aside while I'm doing the driveline, suspension, and steering, putting that all together. I'll be doing it solid, and then I'll be back with some more looks. See you then. Hey there, quick update. As you can see, I've got the drivetrain, the suspension, and the hubs and the steering all on the chassis. Now, I did pose all 6 wheels. It's got the 4 front tires turn and the rear tires, of course, turn in the opposite direction to make for a tighter turning circle. You can, like we were talking about, I wasn't going to make it with a poseable steering. What you can do, if you assemble it per the manual, you can make it so that you can move the wheels and tires freely after the entire model is assembled. You have to heat up the pins and push them together and assemble it in advance. What I want you to know is, if you want to pose it and then glue it in place, all of this can go much faster if you just attach the driveline and the suspension underneath. And all these parts, you don't have to try to assemble and then turn over and have them completely falling apart each time as you mount it onto the chassis. You don't have to do that. You can mount the suspension and drive hubs onto the chassis, glue them in place, and then all the holes and all the pins that you see on those parts, you can take a pair of tweezers and place it, glue it, glue it, place the pin, glue it, place the tie rod, glue it, and glue it all into place, and then also glue it from the top so that it's secured in line. Then you can pose your steering like I will, so when the truck is done, the steering wheels will be locked in a turn, but it won't be steerable, as in I can't move them ever after that. But it will have some look to it, so it looks like it's making a corner. So you can easily do that. You don't have to loosely secure all these on the drive hub like it shows you, and then try to place them on the chassis and have you throwing fits. You can actually leave these individual parts off, which make up the steering box, place the hub on the chassis, and put those in place later and glue them into place and pose your steering and be done with it. So I just want to let you know, super easy to do, and that's one way you can speed up the build. See you in a minute. We've reached the point in the build where I'm going to be doing some more sub-assembly stuff, but I've got the entire bottom hull of the Typhoon assembled. I've got both rows of seats. Aren't those very nice? Now, in the picture that I looked up, they were black vinyl, and that's how I'm doing it. If you go out and find another picture that looks a little different, I don't care. Paint it how you see it. But the pictures I looked up were a white rear interior and a black vinyl seat, and I still have to look up the cab to see exactly what colors were in the cab. Now, the cab is all assembled, but it's not attached. You can see this big open area here. Nothing goes in there. I'm assuming that's, of course, where the engine and whatnot would be, but it has no opening hatches above the engine, so there is no engine to build, which is fine with me, because you'd never see it anyways. So, let's take a look at all the stuff I've assembled. We got the seats together, and those went together great. Those are going to mount on these three areas here in the hull when I get them there, and they will just sit up. But I want to spray those black vinyl, a satin, and then they'll get one on this side and one on this side. And the seat backs, of course, are completely blank because of the fact that it's going to be against the wall. You can't see anything. The interior of the MRAP is going to be a off-white. And then I will pick out the computer screens, the microphone, the speakers that are all in the back of the hull. That's pretty much the inside hull detail. The only way you're going to be able to see it is when the back door is open. And when you got the little six hatches, you know, depending on if I mold any of those open or not. The interior for the cab is done, and that lays in there and lines up beautifully. No issues whatsoever. You can see the seams around there. Once you drip some glue in there, are going to pretty much disappear. That is also a very nice looking sub-assembly that I want to paint individually. They got the little computer screen. They have this little box with a heat sink on it there. There is a little hole for a switch. That thing is super, super, super tiny, and it went flying out of the tweezers. So I'm just going to take a piece of sprue, cut it, glue it in there, and we'll be fine. It'll look just like the switch. The dashboard itself is very cool. It's got all digital instrumentation, the steering wheel. The seats have their little air ride cushions on them. You see I got to trim off some material after I glue it on. It's easier once it's one big piece. The seat backs are completely undetailed because it'll be against the wall of the cab. But that's a very nice looking interior that I can spray one color, the main color, and then pick out all the rest of the details with plenty of room. It's got a separate little shifter there on the floor. Obviously, modern equipment's automatic transmission. The hull has all of its armor on it. It's got all the armor on there. This nose is actually about eight pieces itself, just the nose here. And then this piece of armor that's here is actually three pieces, but you can see the multiple pieces that go into the nose. You've got the little triangle, you got the steps, and the wire mesh step. So that's like so. We've got our side equipment here with all those hatches on. And of course, those don't open. If you really wanted to cut them open, I suppose you could. We've got the shocks, the suspension, the steering. We've got our center armor, which is angled like that to deflect any blasts up and out and away from the vehicle, instead of concentrating all the force on the bottom of a flat vehicle. So it all looks real nice. It all went together well. It's taken me about 3.5 hours to this point, I'd say. So you can expect a lot of time in assembly. Now I'm going to leave this as it is. In the next steps, I'm already up to 15. I'm going to start doing the upper hull. Once I get the upper hull taken care of to where I can get it without putting the windows in it, get the doors on it, I'm not going to have the doors open. I'm going to leave them so that they're closed. At least that's my plan now. Once I get all that, we'll come back, look at that subassembly. Then it'll be time to head to paint. I'm going to paint the interior first. Then I'm going to assemble the top over, seal it down, mask off all the little windows that I put in if I don't put them in right away, and then we'll give it that coat of Russian military modern green. So we're going to keep building. We'll be back in a little bit. See you soon. Hello again. This will be the final subassembly showdown. Now, you've seen a lot more updates in between here because this, what you're looking at in front of you, is about 8 or more hours of build time. It's a lot longer than your standard car, you know, where it's 90 minutes, 2 hours, and bang, I'm ready to paint at the most on cars. This took a lot of work. Now, we saw the lower hull and all its detail with the seats and the interior. So what the rest of the time has been taken up was on the upper hull. Now, that didn't look like it was going to be a lot of work, but it actually was quite a bit of work. For one, all those little tiny grab handles that I showed you when we looked at the parts, 49 of them have to be placed on the top of the hull. 49! You can see them on there in all different various angles and locations. all over the hull, all the little edges, every cross beam. There'll be like two on this side, one on this side, three on this side, two on this side. They're all over the place in different configurations and just little tiny dimples where they go. Not much. It took a long time to develop a strategy to get those on, and the strategy was just two tweezers and a toothpick with glue on it. Dip it in, let the plastic start to set, hold it on, and push it with the Q-tip or the toothpick until it goes in the right position. And it's just a lot of screeching and getting upset until you get it done. The photo etch goes on very nicely. If you're not familiar with photo etch, it is an etched brass component that's very thin that will give you more detail than a cast plastic component. To release them from the sheets or sprues of brass, you can see those little dimples on each side where each one of those was. All you have to do is just push your X-Acto knife against it when it's on the table and snap those parts off, and then use CA glue. Model glue won't have any effect on brass whatsoever. Use CA glue to glue them to their locations and then paint over them. One of the vents had to be bent, so you just put that along a straight edge ruler and fold it up like you would a brake bending metal in real world. All the little tiny details, mirrors, ladders, everything are on the cab. The visor, the windows are not in the cab, of course, because I can paint it then. It's going to be painted modern Russian green. The hatches will open if you desire them to, all seven. I don't have any reason to open them up, but I did leave a couple of them loose without gluing them in completely. So if I did feel like when I'm all done prying one of them up, I could leave it as such. We'll have to paint the inside of the hull. That'll go a whitish color. The cab will go a more of a charcoal color. The back of the interior will go white. Then we'll get the seats painted vinyl black, get those in. We'll detail the back here, and then we'll seal it up. We'll glue on this, which can't go on until it's actually sealed up. Then I'll mask off the little holes for all the windows, and I'll spray it that green. Then we'll attach the door. I want the door to be able to be opened, so that has to be done separately. We got the six wheels. Those will be black. Spray those separately. The manual tells you to put the tires in the wheel when you start. You don't have to. They'll slide on easily, so you can assemble the tires, secure them down, spray them flat black, and then we just have some very small components on the side here for the hinges of the back door so that we can display it open. And this small cage, which goes right up here, but I have to put a marker light there when I'm done. The lights, the headlights, are actually in the front end, but most of the area around them is green except for the fog lights. All I have to do is spray that like I would the normal vehicle. And when I'm done, take a Q-tip with some lacquer thinner, rub it off just where the lights are, and you'll never know that they were painted over. I'm going to get everything in paint right now. I've got a primer at first, then I'm going to paint it. So I'll see you when I got some green stuff on here. As you can see, I've got the primer coat on everything, so that's just a simple gray primer, and that helps with paint adhesion on this plastic. Now, this thing looks kind of like a zebra. What I'm attempting to do is some pre-shading over the primer before I paint. And I'm just using standard craft acrylics to do so. I'm using a pure black and a pure white so that I get really strong shadows. What you want to do is you mix it up, like I've shown you before, with your airbrush. And then you apply it over the high areas and the low areas. So you mix it up, you know, in the standard 50-50, and I usually spray with my fine line airbrush at about 10 psi, so the pressure is really low, so I'm not throwing a buttload of paint on it. First, I give everything a coat of black in the darkest areas. So you'll go in, you'll apply just a little bit of paint, and with an airbrush like this, it's an Iwata off-brand, you can actually get real fine lines and go in between. Now, this does not have to be perfect. In fact, it should not be perfect. It should be a little mottled. It should be a little different. It should be a little various shades. You don't want to have the exact same shade on every single hatch and every single up thing. You don't want to have all of that. But what you want to do is use a little common sense and figure what sits proud of the vehicle and is going to fade the first and what's going to stay darker. Now, I've highlighted all the raised panel divider lines on the MRAP, on the Typhoon. Then these bars down here, since they angle a little up, I've also sprayed those. I've done all the hatches, and then I've dried it and cleared it with a clear acrylic mat. Then I'm going to go on and apply my Mission Models Modern Russian Green, and what that should do is give me a dark and light finish without having to try too hard after I spray the final coat of green on. The bottom of the hull is just done over the primer with black, sprayed on with the airbrush, because that's underneath, it's all going to be the same darker color, and that'll give me some more shadows in the drivetrain and all that when it dries. So I'm going to start shooting this Mission Models color, this modern Russian green, pick that up off of eBay. We're going to see how that turns out and how the pre-shading looks. See you soon. Well, I gave Mission Model paints a shot, and I know a lot of professional model builders love them, say they're amazing. I'm not all that impressed with how they came out. For one thing, they don't tell you until after you buy the paint, and they include a little note inside that you have to use their thinner, you have to use their poly additive, you have to use their primer is what it seems to be saying on there. And I don't want to have to relearn how to paint everything all over again. I don't want to have to relearn how to mix thinner, because their thinners mix at different ratios, and their poly has to be added, and they just give a general add 2 to 10 drops of thinner, add 2 to 10 drops of poly. More poly should be added if you'd like. That doesn't even make any sense to me on that little sheet that they put with the bottle. So I'm not knocking Mission Model paints. I'm sure if you spend the time to learn how to use paints all over again and figure out these paints at $7 an ounce, I don't think it's that great of a deal, but it is a better deal than other model paints, which are like $7 for half that. So I'm going to start from scratch. I already rinsed off this body and got most of the green off. This I'm going to leave and just overcoat, but Mission Model paints just are not for me. But I'm sure that they work beautiful. It was a very nice looking paint. It was a very nice consistency in the bottle. I'm sure they work fine for everyone else. I'm not saying don't ever buy them. I'm just saying I'm going to go back to my craft paints and Tamiya paints. And I know how to use those. And there's no learning curve. And they tell you exactly how much thinner to add to use in an airbrush and at what pressures. And you can find that super easy. So I'll be back when I've got this coated with my trusty old craft paints. We'll see how it looks. All right, final update before the vehicle is done. As you can see, that color modulation worked pretty good on the paint there. It's not just one solid green. You can see on the top there, we've got multiple different shades of green. We can turn it around. You can see that, well, the top's just set over the base right now. It's not attached or snapped over everything. But you can see where you've got the different shades of the lighter green and then the darker green and then the lighter green and how the upward-facing panels. That was painted over that shadowing, and I did that with just some craft paint. I ended up using just a standard green mixed with some white to get that Russian look that I saw in the Mission Model paints that didn't work out so well for me. That probably worked out really well for everybody else. So you can see along the upper rail where it's a little lighter. Along the top, we'll see if we can get it to catch the light, but you can see the different shades where the hatches are a little lighter tone. So I didn't want it real stark, but I did want you to be able to see those lines, and those stand out pretty nice then. Without having to use 15 different colors, I just shaded underneath and that was it. So I have to put in the windows, I have to snap the body all the way down, I have to do some touch-up painting. Once I got the rear door on, I had to put, of course, the corners in, so I have to touch up that paint. Once I get all that done, get the tires on, we'll have the final reveal. We'll be back in a little bit. And here we have it, TACOM's Typhoon K. Completely assembled. There wasn't very many decals in the kit, as we showed you, just the parade stripes, which I didn't want to use, so I just put the Russian star on there, because this thing has no other indication of what unit it's with or anything, so I wanted to have something on there that would indicate that at least it was a Russian vehicle. When someone sees it in my cabinet, they're going to know what it is. Now, it's not a very exciting kit, but I thought it was so cool, and I've seen them on YouTube and stuff. I thought it was kind of a cool-looking vehicle, and I thought, well, if there was a model of one, I'd like to build one, and that's what I did. So it went together relatively easy. I would not recommend this as a first kit by any means. It does have quite a high parts count, and it is some very small fiddly parts, especially the 49 hook loops there. So it would give you a little bit of frustration if this was a first-time kit, but otherwise, not a bad kit at all. Went together pretty good. Take your time, go easy with it. The detailed interior looks nice. If you want to mount the door open and the hatches open and look inside and check that out. The interior of the cab, of course, is just a black and white with black switches. You can look those images up online. There isn't a whole lot out there about the Typhoon K. The Russians aren't too open about military vehicles like we are. Some of the detailing I did before final, of course, I painted the glass with a Tamiya clear green, thinned with rubbing alcohol, so that it wasn't a super dark green. It gives it that extra, extra thick bulletproof glass look. I did use some Panaline washes inside the vents and on the vents on top, the photo etch up there, so it looks like they're darker behind them. And on that side, I love the little ladder there. All the little details make it work, from the little tiny steps to the little grab handles to the little chin shields, you know, the way the doors assemble and all that. Did you know that this is actually a modular vehicle? The cab is separate, so I did highlight with black the cab separation line. When you see them bouncing around out in the field, you can see the cab moving separate from the rest of the vehicle. They can snap off these modules where these joins are and everything and replace it with, you know, weapons or fuel tankers, anything else they want. I did give it some very light dust effects, like it was out on field maneuvers but hasn't been used for a heavy amount, more like a training vehicle or whatnot. What I wanted to do is just give it a little bit of a used look instead of green and black. I like the modulation and the colors. You saw how I did that. If I didn't do that, there wouldn't be this different panel distinction. The darker, the lighter, the darker, the lighter. All you'd have is just a plain green vehicle, and that would be even more boring than that. So I enjoyed the kit. I posed the wheels in a steering position on both sides. The rear wheels barely steer at all, but it does have the full mechanism back there, so they must steer. The front wheels, of course, steer much more, so I position them a little more. Make sure if you're going to pose it steering, the rear tires would aim out while the front tires are aiming in, so that it actually makes a corner and it doesn't crab. If you went all in the same direction, it would crab. Good detail on the kit. For the price, around $50, you can find it online. You can find these from places like Mega Hobby, eBay, mail order houses like that. So, thanks for watching. We will see you at the next review.